It is a real perfection. It is an axiom. An axiom is something, a truth that is never changed. You know, somebody, everybody knows yourself. This is why the Quran says, وَأَنِ الْإِنْسَانُ عَلَىٰ نَفْسِهِ بَصِيرًا وَلَوْ أَلْقَىٰ مَآذِرًا. Everybody among us know your own power, your limitation, your potential, capacity, skills, what you are able to do. So if you are charged to take a responsibility, knowing full well, consciously, you erode between yourself and others. This is why a Muslim is charged to do what is beyond him in time and space. You know that somebody is looking over you, and you are charged to do something. The best thing is to ask yourself, am I qualified to take it? Because now you are going to make a monologue. A monologue means somebody speaking to himself, and you answer yourself. If you know that truly you cannot shoulder the responsibility, please don't take it. Otherwise, it is established in the Sunnah. I mean, a man from a Sahabi to Muhammad Abu Dhar Ghaffari. He came to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asking to be assigned, to be a governor in one of the regions, Islamic regions in Kufa, in Iraq. But Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told him, Abu Dhar Ghaffari, you are weak in your physique is very weak. There is a huge, huge border. I mean, that is incumbent, that is associated with this position. So this thing, and there is another sunnah which is, anybody who comes acting to be enthroned, to be made a leader, we will never give it to him. Because if you know what is there, you know why? Because in the Quran, when you read Surah Al-Ahzab, Surah Al-Ahzab, verse 72, the Quran will tell you, وَلَقَدْ أَرَدْنَا الْأَمَانَةَ عَلَى السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَالْجِبَالِ فَأَبَيْنَ أَنْ يَحْمِلْنَهَا وَشَقْنَ مِنْهَا وَحَمَلَهَا الْإِنْسَانُ إِنَّهُ كَانَ جَحُولًا ظَلُومًا. We have the mountains, the sky, the heavens, the earth to shoulder the responsibility of having free choice. The earth and the sky and the mountains. Imagine how big, how solid a mountain is. How high the heavens is, how big and how firm the earth is. We ask them to be either to be free to choose for themselves, or they are going to do my commandments voluntarily. But you see, these created things, they subdue and said, we are going to do, we are not going to take the responsibility of free choice. Because we are afraid when we take it, we will not be able to charge it all this time. But man, unfortunately, shouldered the responsibility. He took it. When he was asked to discharge the responsibility he refused, he became zaluma. He wronged himself. Jahulan, because he was not aware of the consequences of not doing the responsibility. So you see the meaning? So anybody who knows that you cannot do it, please don't be ashamed, don't be shy, don't say people will see that or that, because tomorrow those people will not be your comfort in the grave. So tell them that I can't do it very soon. This is among the responsibility of a leader. This question, in fact, I answer a question here. That is, it's among the responsibility of a leader whenever he is incapacitated. Whenever he is incapable, he can tell the people, I cannot do it. Let somebody else take my position.
With regards to Sharia law, do women have limitations towards occupying leadership roles? Okay, thank you. What would be the judgment if I am in class attending my lesson while it is prayer time? What would be the judgment if I am in class attending my lesson while it is prayer time? This Olari, what did you say on a Muslim president ruling an entire country?
Another very, very important question. Directly related to the topic of the discussion. That is, what is your say when a Muslim president ruling a non-Sharia country? Countries are not defined or classified Sharia country or non-Sharia country. Sharia is related to the community, not to the country. The country is a political entity, and a Sharia is a comprehensive system of rules, regulations, imperatives, prohibitions, commendables that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the constitution or the basis of existence and interaction in our dealings with Him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and among ourselves. So what is the Sharia? Sharia is implemented upon people and it is executed by people as well. So there is nothing called a Sharia country or a non-Sharia country, because Muslims are a community, a nation, but it is not a country. You cannot say a Muslim country, but you can say a Muslim community. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran he says, وَكَذَلِكَ وَكُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ. You are the best, you are the epitome, you are the perfection, you are the incarnation of a perfect nation that has ever been revealed for mankind. So for that matter, when we say a leader ruling a non-Sharia country, what I think the meaning is obviously understood. But it doesn't call a Sharia country, but Sharia is implemented in a community. There is a Muslim community, there is no Muslim country. Because a state is a physical entity, a geographical location, where everybody, a Muslim, a non-Muslim, are residing, and the identity is your birthright. You were born there, or you cultivate the nationality of that community, or that physical geographical identity, or identity. So a leader ruling people, because it is another sign of weakness, another ignoble departure, disgusting from the true spirit of Islam. When Muslims are so much hypnotized, are so much detached and disconnected, tragically, from the reality of deen, that is Islam. In fact, Sharia, we partially implement some of it, the other part of it is never seen or even heard. To the point, people have even distorted Islam by just taking, according to their whims and wishes, a tiny portion of the entire body of Sharia, implementing that and foregoing the other, not implementing that. So a leader ruling over people, you know, it is a social contract. It's a social need. If the society is a Muslim, a true Islamic community, they would demand that they would be ruled by the Sharia. But the Sharia, objective of a Sharia is justice, righteousness, doing things that are advantageous and beneficial to society, and showing things, preventing things, prohibiting things, and fighting against any deviation that is going to be disadvantageous or going to be harmful, detrimental, and that is going to go against the interests of the community. So a leader ruling over a community should have been the reverse, the community ruling over the leader. If the community is not able to implement Sharia, you don't expect somebody at the top there implementation shall be upon the table. Because we say everybody is a leader in Islam. In the sense that you are going to be questioned independently. It is not your leader or your follower who is going to intercede on your behalf. So you are enjoying to do it at your personal level, according to your personal effort, according to your personal understanding, and you are going to be rewarded personally, individually. In fact, the act and the reward is personalized, it has a personal nature. So for that matter, when a leader is a Muslim, the community has to allow him. When the community is a Christian, the leader has to just try to call the community to Islam. If they accept and they become true Muslims, then he can just invite them to implement the Sharia. Because the Sharia is never imposed. It is discussed and accepted free will on your freedom. You don't impose the Sharia. The Sharia, you pick people, you instruct them. When they are true Muslims, they themselves demand for its implementation.
Thank you very much for that wonderful response. This sort of question is, if a Muslim leader is not doing his or her duties as expected and he denied to resign due to social status, what do you expect the followers to do? If a leader or leader is not doing his or her duties as expected and he denied to resign due to social status, what do you expect the followers to do?
Well, actually, I think when we assign a leader or we elect and appoint somebody to be a leader, naturally we expect him to fulfill and execute and implement whatever we ask him to do. Because we are the source of powers. We mandated that power to him and that authority. We gave him two things. We gave him power and authority. They are two independent things, but they are complementary. With power, that's the physical side of it. With authority, that's the spiritual and the immaterial aspect of power. It is that vote that we gave him that made him a leader. And our taxes provide security, the military and the police for him. So that is the power that we assign to him. If he fails to do as expected, I think the ballot box is dead. When we go to elections, we vote him out of office. But we don't resort to violence, because violence is always counteracted by violence. Then the cycle of violence keeps repeating itself away. And in violence, everything comes to a stop. Even if people are living, they are dead people. Because people living in fear, in fright, are people who can never create, who can never develop, who can never even think of who they are. Much less to do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked them to do.
Thank you very much. This other question is, what is the Islamic ruling on reciting Surah Al-Ikhlas 11 times in a great year?
Well, the people who are espousing, who are propagating, who are, well, I don't know how to say it. Well, these are things that we actually found in our Islamic, this broad Islamic literature. We found it in our Islamic literature, but it is not supported by any authentic, any valid practice of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is no hadith that would actually support the claim that reciting Surah Al-Ikhlas 11 times would produce so and so an effect or an impact. In fact, Surah Al-Ikhlas is entirely, in fact, you know, some people would call it the heart of the Quran. Because Surah Al-Ikhlas is incomparable. It is unique in the sense that it tells you everything about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a very, very short, powerful, I mean, pregnant, very short verses. Qul huwa Allahu ahad, as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling Muhammad, say it in response to an inquiry, to a satirical question. Somebody saying, is it logical or sensible to reduce all the gods and make them into one God? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in that powerful response, what we call that decisive silencer of a spiritual powerful warning. He says, Qul say, transmit it to them, Allahu, Qul huwa Allahu ahad. When the one ahad here tells you that in his qualities, in his attributes, there is nothing like him, ahad. He didn't say, Qul huwa Allahu wahidu. He says, Qul huwa Allahu ahad. No, nothing, nobody shares his qualities and attributes. So this is why the word ahad is here mentioned. Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Allahu samad. He is the Lord, the superior, upon which everything else depends. He does not need anything for his existence. And to interpret and make it very much simplified to you as a Gambian, he says, Lam yalid, he never bears children. Walam yulad, he has not been born by any person or any other thing, then he does not need anything. He has not given birth to anything, neither anything else has given birth to him. He existed before existence. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا. Nothing is equal to him in all aspects. This is why Ahadun is repeated after the word Ahadun was mentioned at the beginning of the chapter. So this is telling you the meaning of what is unity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, At-Tawheed, to hold Allah in unity, that He is one, unique in every aspect of His attributes. But it has nothing to do, it is not a prayer. There is no formula, there is no verse that tells you that it's a prayer. It is just confirming, stressing, solidifying a reality, a truth that is inexorable, that cannot be changed. So you read it, you understand it, you don't read it, supplicating Allah for it. But if at all you don't know, because the Quran is for what you read it for. When you read it with that clean mind, that you are asking Allah's blessings, Allah will give it to you based on your intention. But we don't take this religion from the way people understand it. This religion is taken from Muhammad and the companions, and it is repeated, transmitted accordingly until it is now here. So we don't take religion from people, because that person is man. Man is a creature subjected to time and space. He was born, he's going to die, and he's going to be resurrected. So everything is limited in man.
Thank you very much. This is other question. With regard to Sharia law, do women have limitation towards occupying leadership role? Towards occupying leadership role?
Well, actually, this is another very controversial issue in Islam or in Islamic religious discourse. You know why? Because there are different views and colors, different school of thoughts, different opinions based on different cultural backgrounds, historical realities combined together, infused into some of our religious understanding. And some people took them as religious literature while they are purely cultural, social realities. Whether a woman should occupy a position of leadership. But what do we mean by leadership? If a woman is not allowed to occupy a position of leadership, the world is bound to go into knots.